thank God for a new week, and I want to command that this week the orb of the prophetic orb of this week will bring forth that which God has ordained for each one of us. I command the prophetic orb of this week to give up everything that it has in store for each one of us in the name of Jesus. From the beginning of this Monday all the way to the whole week, I decree the favor of God will be upon our lives in the name of Jesus. Now, this morning, as I have been feeling it for a few hours from yesterday, I want to correct an error. I want to correct an error by the help of the Holy Spirit, and I've written quite some things, because that's one of the assignments the Lord has given me, to restore order in the church. I want to do that faithfully by the grace of God. Kindly, as you come on board, come over with a friend, wake them up. Let us talk. Amen. Now, I want us to correct the error, and the question the Lord put in my spirit is, does a prodigal son or a foreign son require or need deliverance? Does a prodigal son, according to the word of God, does a prodigal son or a foreign son, if my son goes out of my house or my presence and things do not work well out there, the Bible says that the devil is like a roaring lion. You know, he's moving loud, strolling around, you know, like a roaring lion looking for somebody to devour, and he goes out there and the devil has devoured him. Does he require deliverance? You know, we want to look into that with the backup of the scriptures, because we cannot just handle things the way we want to handle them and then we cover up in the name church. Yesterday I woke up and I sent something about 2 days ago, sorry, and I said, you know, there is what we are calling church. Not everything calling itself church is church. You know, Jesus set the foundation very clear, you know, very clear for the church. The Bible says he laid the foundation. Paul is saying, and no other can any other man lay. There is no any other. The foundation of the church is laid. My brethren, if we do not see some of these things in the ministry of Jesus Christ, we cannot copy that. We cannot have that. It does not matter who is saying that. Like now, somebody selling different oils, you know, packed oils. Packed oils or packed water or salt and all those things, and saying that I have prayed for these things and my grace is in them. Some stickers, when you go with this, you know, I'll be watching over you, you know, my presence will go with you. We don't need the presence of a man or a woman of God to go with you. There is no biblical backup. There is no biblical backup. What we need is the presence of God. Exodus chapter 33. If your presence does not go with us, we don't need men and women of God. We don't have that ability of depositing the grace of sharing in a small portion of some small oils, oils of gladness. I don't know. There are 7 types of oils. My God, hallelujah. What I know is in the book of Isaiah, you know, the different components or the different attributes of the Spirit of God that were released in the life of Jesus, you know, spirit of wisdom, spirit of might, spirit of counsel, blah blah, those ones, hallelujah. But you cannot, I cannot share my grace, I cannot remove it, I don't have the ability, and put it and stock it in some small bottles, and then I'm selling it in form of oil. My God, freely we were given, freely we give. Why are we selling stuffs? Why are we selling the old church? Why are you buying these things? There is no way. Why are you buying these things? It is not biblical. And that's why you see people are now attracted to men instead of being attracted to God, because we are drawing them to ourselves instead of drawing them to God. Amen. And this is an error that has to be corrected. The church, I want to let you know, there is no grace of a man of God that can be deposited in an oil, you know, in any bottle of an oil. It is not biblical. There is no biblical backup of this thing we are doing. Amen. I know once in a while God can use a prophet or a servant of God to do a prophetic operation, but that is it. Don't make it a doctrine. Hallelujah. Don't make it a doctrine. My God, you'd even go to pray for somebody and the Lord tells you, give them Holy Communion. There is nothing there. Just give them water. Pray for it. That is it. But then you don't now begin selling to us water with your sticker. That is the blood of Jesus. Amen. So let us be very, very careful. Let us be very, very careful so that the church can be edified in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now we're asking ourselves, when a prodigal son fell from the presence of the father, did he need deliverance? Did he need deliverance? Did he need any class, any deliverance class out there? If he met with the prophet of our today, the prophet would have, taken him through some classes of deliverance. But does he need that? The foundation, the stories that are written in the Bible, they are an example to us. You know, they are an example to us. Amen. Now, church, anyone who is in Christ, 2 Corinthians 5 and 7 and 17, anyone who is in Jesus Christ, if you come to Jesus Christ, you attain an attribute of a new creation. You are a new creation. So everything of the old, hallelujah, is gone. Behold, the Bible says everything has become new. Now, in that we become one with him. You know, our bodies become his temples. Amen. That means they become his dwelling place. Amen. If our bodies be the dwelling place of God, hallelujah, I want each one of us to know that our God is holy. Romans 6, 5 to 7. I'll give you so many scriptures today because it is good to have the backup of the word of God. Now, there is no any other way that an evil spirit, amen, there is no way if the spirit of God is deposited in me, and if Jesus and the Father have made a home, you know, in the book of John, Jesus is saying that if you love me, if you keep my commandments, me and my Father, because we are one, we shall come and make a home. We shall abode in you. Hallelujah. There is no way then another kingdom, hallelujah, can abode in my body. There is no way. If I remain in the ways of the Lord, if I walk in the counsel of God, if I walk in wisdom, if I walk in the fear of God, if I walk in the reference of God, if I run or free from any mention of sin, if I'm read by the Spirit of God, there is no way another spirit can inhabit my life, no matter what. You know, as I was meditating on this word over the night, the Spirit of God was reminding me, because I had somebody would watch this and say, woman of God, you know, somebody can throw into your life or can bring into your life, you know, a demonic spirit or an evil spirit by what you eat and blah blah blah. Now, even by the time I get there, so that person can give me that whatever they have from the kingdom of darkness, my God, because I have ripped, prayed up like Daniel, I will say no, I will reject it, not once, not twice, my God. We have gone places, and the Lord, my God, one time the Lord said, send me to one of a region in my nation, and he told me the table was set, and actually I was not fasting, and I love fish, you know, the meal was there, and we were it was a buffet, so everybody was going to pick the food for themselves, but the bread that was placed on my table, the Lord told me, don't eat with this bread, exchange this. Hallelujah. That is it. You are so prayed up, your spiritual man is very alert. Hallelujah. And even if you ate and it is not okay, psalmist is saying, my Jehovah, even when we drink poison, it will not by any means harm us. So there is no cause for alarm. Amen. There is no cause for alarm. Amen. That is it. God will protect his own, and he is going to order our steps in the name of Jesus. Amen. So there is no any other way other spirits can dwell on me, can he dwell on my life, can he dwell your life as a son of God, if your life with God is all right. The Holy Spirit indwells us too, and he reminds us, he is there to counsel us, he's here to help us, my God. He is there to teach us. Amen. Because we already adopted Ephesians chapter 4 verse 11, why the fivefold ministries were given. Amen. It's for the edification, for the equipping of the body of Jesus Christ, so that we may all attain, my Jehovah, that maturity, you know, that full stature of the Son of God. Amen. And if you look at the ministry of Jesus Christ, he even went with the, you know, people were saying Zacchaeus is a sinner. He went there and you know, he dined with that, because he said, I'm dining with you, Jehovah Redeemer, because when I come under your roof, I am in charge, I am an authority, I am the king, I am the priest. Hallelujah. And what do we see? We see he's not fearing to eat in that house. Jesus is not fearing to eat in that house. Why? Because I am in charge. Hallelujah. It does not matter the other services or the other sacrifices Zacchaeus had offered. I am now in charge. And he received me. And immediately he received me, he was given the power to become the son. Amen. So we have to put on Christ. The Bible says we put on Christ. So we must purpose Romans 13 and verse 14. And Jesus is in us, the hope of glory. Therefore, my brethren, Satan and everything about him, my God, is already a defeated foe, is already a defeated kingdom. Amen. They have no access unless you give them the access. Amen. Jesus has overcome the world, and he left us, and he said, you are more than conquerors. John 16 and verse 33. Amen. We are already seated. I'm going to say so many scriptures. We are already seated. I want to show you how, if you are in Christ and you fall off, you don't need deliverance. My God, you need to return back home. Prodigal son, when you fall off, when you remove yourself from the presence of the Father and you go out there and things are not working well for you, you know there is dryness. You are even feeding on what you're not supposed to be feeding. My God, you have squandered your wealth. You are living in prostitution. That is not the foundation your Father gave you. So you don't need deliverance there. The devil is not in you, my Jehovah God. It is you as a son who has removed yourself from the presence of your Father. So what you need is not a deliverance class. You don't even need an anointing service. Hallelujah. It is you sober up, come back to your senses and go back to the presence of your Father. Hallelujah. So we already seated with Christ in heavenly places, far beyond, you know, the rulers of darkness, the principalities, and these things Jesus already overcame. Hallelujah. Ephesians 1:20-21. We are born of God. We must therefore overcome the world. Hallelujah. 1 John 5 and verse 4. Yeah, little children, hallelujah, you are of God. Hallelujah. We are born of him, so we must overcome the world. We must say no to the pressure of the world. We must say no to the desires of this world. Hallelujah. Because this world has a father of all eyes. He's the devil. Amen. So we must say no. And he's rolling loud like a lion. He's not the lion. He's like a lion looking for somebody to devour. So when you are a son of God and you are misplaced, you know, you go to interact, you know, out there, the devil will hit you. He will mess up with you. So what do you need? You don't need deliverance. My God, you need to come back to your senses and return back. Actually, I say what you need is salvation. My God, you need to be restored to who you are, what you are, and how you are supposed to be as a son of God. Amen. Now, Jesus is the word of God who came dwelt among us as 1 John, John chapter 1. John chapter 1, and John chapter 1 from verse 12 down there. You can even begin from verse 10. You know, he became flesh and dwelt among us. So as Jesus was interacting with the people here, he said, I am the truth. That is, and truth is the word of God. Amen. And that is it. Hallelujah. So he dwelt among us. So as he interacted with the people, the people who rubbed the shoulders with him, that's why the Bible says, when people congregated around him, he did not anoint them. He did not begin laying his hands on them and applying, you know, some packed up oils. He did not begin saying to them, when he entered in the temple and somebody was inflicted by an evil spirit, he did not look for an anointing oil. He to begin applying them or begin calling them for classes. Actually, immediately demons perceived him. What in one instance they're asking, what do we have to do with that son of God? Amen. They knew him. They knew him. They discerned him. Hallelujah. And they trembled. Hallelujah. That's why the Bible says, even in the mention of the name of Jesus, demons trembled. Hallelujah. So he came to destroy the works of Satan, and he came to give us life and life in abundance. Therefore, when one is saved, the sinful nature cannot dominate them. The sinful nature cannot dominate you when you are born again. The sinful nature should not dominate you. And that's why I'm saying, well, you know, when you are born again, when you receive Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you know, Jesus Christ comes in you. Paul is saying that he's in us the hope of glory. So he's deposited by faith in us. and with his father because they are one. They make a home in our lives. That's why our bodies become the temples of God. And the Holy Spirit, the helper, the other helper comes. Because actually for us to be convicted, to be born again, that is the working of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. So there is no way, if I live right according, if you obey my commands, if you love me and keep my commands, there is no way, again, my brethren, if you are read of the Spirit of God as a son of God, because that's what the Bible says. Amen. As, you know, as sons of God are those who are led by the Spirit of God. There is no way, my brethren, by whatever means, hallelujah, I say again, the seed of nature, we are human beings, we have the flesh, and the flesh does not born, get born again. So it is you suppress it. You know, by the Spirit of God taking charge of your life, then the sinful nature is suppressed. You know, it is kept, it is, thank you, Holy Spirit, it is subjected to the authority of the Holy Spirit of God. So there are things you don't want to do. And even Paul is saying that, you know, every time I want to do good, I just find myself doing bad. Amen. But you because why? We have the sinful nature, that if you're not led of the Spirit of God, that sinful nature can still arise, it can still be aroused. Hallelujah. So you submit it every time. You know, you crucify the body and the desires of the flesh every time. You crucify the body and the desires of the flesh every time. Hallelujah. You die to self, kenosis, whatever you can pronounce it. Hallelujah. Dying to self. Hallelujah. Romans 8:5-8, amen. And I would want to read some of these scriptures. Romans 5, I was marking them. Read this, read that. Not all of them. I'm not going to read all of them, but let us read that particular portion of the scripture. The Bible says in Romans 8:5-8, Romans 8:5-8, the Bible says, for those who live according to the flesh, listen to this. This is the church. For those who live according to the flesh, set their minds on the things of the flesh. But those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. So we are sons of God. So we are led by the Spirit of God. So we should live according to the Spirit. That means our minds are set on the things of the Spirit. We cannot do carnal things. Amen. We cannot gratify the desires of the flesh. We cannot move from the presence of the Father. Because we know when we do that, you know, the devil, you know, he's our enemy. He's looking for us to devour us when we go. When we meet him in his vicinity, okay? So the Bible says, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace, okay? So we enjoy peace, we enjoy life, amen, and life in abundance when we are spiritually led, hallelujah. But when you are carnal, when you are carnally minded, my daughter, that is death, and that's a result of sin. Hallelujah. So because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God, nor indeed can be. So then, those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But those who are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now, if anyone does not have the Spirit of God, of Christ, he is not his. Hallelujah. That means you're not born again. Amen. And those who are led by the Spirit of God. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. Hallelujah. Now, you are adopted as a son. Therefore, brethren, we are not debtors. We are debtors not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. Are you hearing this? For if you are, if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death, are you seeing this? The deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. For you, did not receive the spirit of both bondage again to fear, but you received the Spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. Are you hearing this? The Spirit of God bears witness. Amen. The Spirit of God is, when you are born again, the Spirit of God bears witness that you are a son of God. That means you are read by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Amen. That is where we are, my brethren. Now, Romans 8 and verse 14, we have read that. Ephesians 1, 4 to 6, hallelujah. God chose us before the creation of the world, so that we may be holy and blameless in his sight. Amen. Romans chapter 1. Ephesians chapter 1, some many scriptures today. Let us look at the word of God, because we are correcting the error. We are correcting the error today. Ephesians chapter 1, 4 to 6. The Bible says, Ephesians chapter 1, 4 to 6. The Bible says, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love, having predestined us to adoption as sons by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his own will. Hallelujah. So we are supposed to be blameless. We are supposed to live a holy life. And this one is not our working. This is the working of the Holy Spirit of God. That is why you must be obedient. We must be obedient. I'm also preaching to myself. We must be willing. You know, we have received the adoption, the sons of God. So we must be willing to live according to the reading of the Holy Spirit, so that we don't gratify. The flesh can always arise if you give it an opportunity, if you give it a leeway. But if you purpose to live a holy life, there is no way you squander your inheritance. There is no way, even after getting your inheritance from your father, there is no way you're going to go out of his presence. You're going to stick there in his presence, because you need counsel for tomorrow, because you need to be enlightened. You have not handled wealth before. Amen. So you're going to stick there so that he can teach you. The father is source. Father, the fathering grace is a source grace. Hallelujah. So that you can get, and the source means you can get or acquire all what you need in your life, because you are a son. That's why you see in the ministry of Jesus, he's not disconnecting himself from the Father. The Bible says, I always do what I see my Father do. I always say what I hear my Father say. So even as I do my things here, you know, my interaction with my Father is still intact. I can perceive the mind of my Father. I can perceive his heartbeat, so that I speak his will, so that I do his will, so that I handle his will. Hallelujah. Because I am a son who is on a Father's assignment. I don't live on my own. Hallelujah. I am a sent one. Amen. And we must know that we are sent one. We are ambassadors of Christ here. Not by just saying I am a Christian. You know, Jesus did not leave anything called Christianity. Jesus did not leave that. Show me the scripture. He did not tell the disciples, I leave you in a church, in a religious setup that is called Christianity. No, Jesus died, and he came to reconcile us. He came to reconcile us back to the Father, and he left to us the ministry of reconciliation. He came to raise more sons to his Father. Hallelujah. He came to raise his, that's why the Bible says he's our firstborn brother. Hallelujah. We are all sons, but he's our elder brother. So he's coming for the sons. He's coming for his fellow brothers, his fellow brethren. He's not coming for Christians. So those who are covering up because somebody poured some water on you, or somebody took you through some fire, and whatever form of baptism you have gone through, and they gave you another name. You know, they are human names, my Jehovah God. So you believe you have qualified to be a Christian. No, those are religious activities. Is there a saying? You know, those kind of activities, he's calling them few the lads. None of these activities will take us to heaven. None of them will take us to heaven. Hallelujah. None of them will take us to heaven. Amen. Now, the Bible says in John 8 and verse 32, if the Son of God has set you free, my Jehovah, you know, the Son of God is the truth. Jesus is the truth. He's the word, the truth. Hallelujah. Now, what we need is the word of God. What we need is the word of God to be set free. John is saying, when Jesus has set you free, you are free indeed. That means the word of God, who is Jesus? The word of God is able to set you free. And that's why you see Jesus, the people who are gathering around Jesus in thousands. Don't tell me there was nobody who had an issue with affliction or being afflicted by any evil spirit. But what do we see? Jesus is not measuring on delivering them in masses. My Jehovah God, no. What do we see? He's not calling them to lay hands on them and smear some human produced oils. What do we see? Jesus is, when they gather, He majored on teaching them the word of God, because the word of God, my child, I've always said, and listen to me, church, I am a voice of God in this generation by the grace of God. I'm doing it in the counsel of God, and I will speak out. My Jehovah, if the word of God, my God, we are seeing nowadays in the church of Jesus Christ, whatever they are calling church, and I've always said that is not church. Hallelujah. They major so much. They waste. The word of God is given 45 minutes. I attended Acacia in one of the nations in this world. My Jehovah God, my God, I was the guest minister. I was given 45 minutes to minister. Thank God for the grace. Hallelujah. But I'm telling you, it was an overnight meeting. My Jehovah, from nine, I was given between 11 and midnight to minister the word of God. From there up to 10 a.m. the following day. My God, it was a process of prophecy. My Jehovah, Papa, go deeper. Hallelujah. I receive. You know, my Jehovah, I hear, I see. I see something buried in your house. I see a box, a green box in your bedroom. For all those hours, my Jehovah, from the time I finished ministering, there was no prayer, there was nothing. Papa, go deeper. Papa, I prophesy. Hey, can I prophesy? Hallelujah. And my God, I was pissed up until I left and went back to stay in the car of the person who was hosting me, because they had taken me to go and minister there. Hallelujah. Now listen to this. Jesus majored on teaching people the word of God, because what? It is the word that is able to deliver you. It is the word that when you sit down under the counsel of the teaching of the word of God, running the word of God, my God, some of the things you are struggling with could be the thing of the past. My Jehovah, you don't need anybody to take you through deliverance classes. Amen. Now, John 15 and verse 3, the word Jesus taught the disciples, you know, his message, John 15 and verse 3, he taught them that word has made them clean. As he was teaching them, that word was cleansing them. That word was purifying them. It was purging them. Hallelujah. So the word Jesus, or the message Jesus was teaching the disciples as he interacted with them. That's why I tell people, kindly sit under the counsel of a true servant of God. Because why? They are ignited by the word of God. There is a deposit of the word of God in their lives. When you interact with them, as they continue teaching you the word of God, that word alone is able to purify you. It is able to purge, you know, to purge you. Hallelujah. It is able to rectify the error. It is at the sitting of the counsel of the word of God where you'll be able to notice, oh my God, so this was not the direction. I came to realize even some of the women who are fornicating, I encountered some of them who are fornicating with the men of God in the houses of God, in quotes. Hallelujah. It's because they have not, under the counsel of that man of God, they have not been taught that sleeping with a man of God is not getting anointing. My Jehovah, it's not getting impartation. It is sin, because sex outside marriage, whether with a man of God or with a woman of God, it is not getting impartation. That is sin. Hallelujah. And that one has to be corrected. But because when they are seated there, what they hear is miracles. I receive, blah, blah, my Jehovah. I've had people come for counsel, my God, because somebody called a father in the Lord. Amen. My Jehovah Redeemer began touching a boy. It's a father began touching a boy, you know, who is a keyboardist, a choir master, blah, blah, in their private parts. And the next thing you see, you know, I'll pay you a house, I'll do this, I'll be sleeping with you, and in the office of the church or in a region somewhere, you know, because somebody has been made a PA to the man of God, and this is a son in the house. The next thing you see, the man of God is sleeping with his boy in a hotel. He goes with them outside the country, my Jehovah God, and what do you see? He's sleeping with them. They share the bed, and he's sleeping with these people. He's calling them his PAs and their boys, you know, the PAs and the security and a woman of God, and he's sleeping. She's a lesbian. The man of God is a gay. Hallelujah. These things are there, and because these things have not been taught by the same man of God, they have not been taught under the same roof by that same man of God. So you think, because he's saying, I hear, I see. No, you think they are qualified, my God, by Jesus. Now, how are you able to discern this? If somebody is not teaching you, and that's why I tell the church, you may not be able to read, but the Spirit of God will be able to teach you. When the deposit of the Spirit of God is in you, you'll be able to perceive whether that person is in the Spirit of God or whether that person is carnal. Because there are some things you cannot do. So Jesus is saying, the word I'm speaking to you, the word I have spoken to you, you know, the message you have heard from me, it is purging you, it is purifying you. You have already been made clean. So I don't need any anointing oil on my face. My God, hallelujah, by Jehovah God. 2 Corinthians 3 and verse 17, where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty, there is freedom. Hallelujah. And that can only be found when you stick in the presence of the Father. The Spirit of God is very gentle. That's why Paul is saying in the book of Thessalonians, don't grieve him. Amen. Don't grieve him. He's very gentle. My God, coming in your life is easy, but living is also very easy. The Spirit of God is very gentle. So the Spirit of God, where the Spirit of God is, there is liberty. As we continue hearing the word of God, men of God, as we continue teaching people the word of God, and we are moving in the Spirit of God, we are dining in the Spirit of God, they will receive their freedom. They will receive their freedom. Hallelujah. So we don't need other gimmicks. We don't need to sell to them after the service. You don't need to sell to them your oil that is carrying your grace. You don't need to sell to them your stickers with your photos, so that you can be watching them in their bedroom, in their businesses. You don't need that. You don't need that. 2 Corinthians 5, 18 and verse 19. Romans 5, 8 and verse 11. We have already been reconciled back to God through Christ. We have already been reconciled back to God through Christ. We therefore just need to get back to him. We have already been reconciled. And if you have removed yourself by any means from his presence, you don't need an anointing service. You don't need to buy any sticker. You don't need to buy anything. You just need to come back to your senses and go back to the presence of your Father. Because why? Jesus already finished with the ministry of reconciling us back to our Father. Okay? So we just need that. Amen. Now, in the ministry of Jesus, who is the owner and the head of the church, we see and witness him casting out demons. We had somebody in the midst of his disciples. We had somebody who was a doubter, somebody like Thomas. We have somebody who is a very wicked. Judas was even stealing the money of the offering, the ministry of Jesus. But what do we see? He's not casting demons out of them. We don't see Jesus casting demons out of Thomas. Thomas just needs. And that's why you see, he needs just to interact with me more. I just need to have a fellowship one-on-one as I'm interacting with my disciples. I just need to have to know the weaknesses of my disciples. Now, you remember in resurrection, when Jesus appeared to the disciples, Thomas was not in the house. So when he came, he doubted. What do we see? Jesus is appearing because he's a Father of grace. He's a source. He's appearing. And now he's showing Thomas, you know, the heart. The holes on his heart where the nails were pierced, my God, during crucifixion, amen, so that he could believe, amen. Jesus knew, these are weakness. This is my disciple. This is my son. This is a weakness. So Jesus did not take Thomas through a deliverance class. Hallelujah. He just needed to appear. Jesus is word. Hallelujah. So what Thomas is interacting with is the word. Hallelujah. The interaction of the word, amen. And what do we see? The Bible says, and he believed. Amen. He believed. That is it. Amen. So imagine, in the ministry of Jesus, Jesus knew who Judas is. We don't see him casting out demons in the life of Judas. Jesus continued with the ministry of teaching people the word of God. Hallelujah. Once in a while, you know, Jesus did the ministry of deliverance, but not to the people who had believed in him. Hallelujah. You cannot be a believer and a demon-possessed person at the same time. Two kingdoms cannot stay in the temple of God. It cannot work. There's no scripture backup. Now, one time, Peter, you know, when Jesus spoke about his death and blah, blah, Peter called him aside and he tried to collect him. What do we see? Jesus is rebuking Peter. Jesus is rebuking Peter and telling Peter, get behind me, Satan. Now, it is not Peter as a person, you know, as per se. Jesus was calling a demon. It is a spirit that had entered, that was speaking in the life of Peter. That is an evil spirit, a spirit that is not agreeing with the word. Hallelujah. Jesus is the word. So Peter, the spirit that has entered you, that is not agreeing with me as a word, that is an evil spirit. Hallelujah. And that is it. This is the spirit Jesus is saying, get behind me, Satan. Hallelujah. So the people Jesus delivered were not believers in him. They were not believers. Hallelujah. They were not believers. Amen. Because a believer, somebody who has become a son of God, cannot be oppressed by demons. Where will the demon access me from? Hey, hallelujah, church. Hallelujah. Now, Now we yes, Jesus rebuked. So it is upon each one of us to understand that we each one of us we must that's why we must live a holy life. That's why we cannot drive ourselves or we cannot remove ourselves from the presence of our Father. Now what do we see? When the prodigal son removed himself from the presence of his father, what do we see? He's encountering, you know, a different atmosphere, demonic oppression. You know, somebody is eating with pigs. You know, somebody is even dining with the prostitute and they're squandering his world with the prostitute and a kind of a life that the father had not given him a foundation of. Why? Because he removed himself from the presence of the father. Now, what that son needed, what that prodigal son needed, it's not a preacher, my God, to sell to him oil of deliverance, not a deliverance class. He needed, as an individual, my God, as an individual, you are a son who has a father. You belong to your father. So what you need is not a deliverance class. What you need is not to drink anointing oil. What you need is not somebody to smear you anointing oil. What you need is get back to your senses and take your feet and return back to the presence of your father. Because your restoration is in your father. Your healing is in your father. Hallelujah. And God is his reward. Amen. John chapter 1, from the beginning of the word. Hallelujah. So that is what the son needed. Hallelujah. So, and I've always said, which is the truth? What kind of a person, when you fall off from the presence of your father and you find that you are struggling with fornication, you find that you are struggling with lies, you find that you are struggling with the things that are not written in the word of God, you know, the fruit of the spirit, and you find that the work of the flesh is working on you, have already read the scriptures, is because you have decided to be carnal. Hallelujah. You have decided to be carnally minded. So what you need is not deliverance. You need to get back to your father. You need to relocate the bearing and go back to where you belong as a son of God. Hallelujah. So you need to turn back. You need, because it's only the truth that can set you free. You need the word that is able to set you free. Amen. So Matthew 10 verse 1 to 8. Hallelujah. Jesus gave the 12, you know, when he was sending them out, he gave them the power and authority to cast out demons, go healing, go casting out demons, and teaching the word and blah, blah, you know. Now, these people, Jesus is sending, he's telling the disciples, I said you amongst wolves, you are a sheep, but I'm sending you amongst wolves, hallelujah, and he's giving them the instruction. Now, these people he sent them to. He sent them to, hallelujah, my Jehovah God, oh my God. Let me read for you these scriptures. Let me read for you this. You know, we want to read the word of God and we want to handle it the way we want to handle it, so that it can fit what we want to do. So that it can fit that I've been said into you oil. Matthew 10, verse 1, Matthew 10, the Bible says, so Jesus is saying, the Bible says, in verse 5, he's telling them, these 12 Jesus sent out and commanded them, saying, do not go into the way of the Gentiles, and do not enter a city of the Samaritan. I don't have time to explain that. Then he's telling them, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Hallelujah. The lost sheep of the house of Israel, those people who have not received Christ, those people who have not known me, hallelujah, and they are destined to know me, those people, hallelujah. Now listen, not those who are born again, you know, I'm sending you to the lost. So the lost one is supposed to be recaptured, to be recovered. If something is lost, my God, and it belongs to you, what do we need to help is to get it back. Hallelujah. So that is a returning. That is a restoration. That is a reconciliation. Hallelujah. Oh my God. Hallelujah. Amen. Go preach saying the kingdom of God. Heal the sick. Cleanse the lepers. Hallelujah. So that means those people, are not in the knowledge of the truth. Amen. Let me show you. So and he told them, freely you are given, freely you should give. So when we go to do this, whatever God has called us to do, we are not charging anything, and that's why we are collecting the error. When you're going to see the man of God, it's good to honor the servants of God. My God, Saul is saying, we cannot go to the seer empty-handed. It's good to honor the servants of God. But what do we see? The woman with the issue of blood, she did not sow any seed. She had nothing to sow. Actually, the Bible says she had sowed everything she had. So she had not even offering. Hallelujah. And that's what you see in the ministry of Jesus. He's not majoring so much on those things. Amen. She did not even coerce somebody like Mary Magdalene to give in her ministry. My God, Jesus, I mean, to give in his ministry. Mary Magdalene is just acting as the Spirit of God is leading her. Amen. The spices and the women going to the tomb, Jesus did not ask them to do that. They knew the ministry because they were believers. The ministry, I mean, the Spirit of God deposited into them different ministries and different gifts in their lives, so they were able to serve in the ministry of Jesus. Hallelujah. Without anybody forcing them. So what do you see in the ministry of the disciples? One time, as they were ministering, they encountered this girl who was a diviner, who was making money for her master, and you know, she spoke the truth. That's why if you're not born again, the diviners will sell to you oil, the sorcerers covering up in the church, they will sell to you their stickers, and you'll make them rich. Hey, hallelujah, my God. You sow everything, you give them everything, you know, and nothing is changing in your life. That's why people are called for deliverance this today, tomorrow again deliverance, to the same people deliverance, and you take your money there, deliverance again, you know. Hey, hallelujah. And that is not so from the beginning. When I major on teaching the truth, the word of God, people will be delivered, not by me, by the word of God. Hallelujah. Simeon the sorcerer, my God, after encountering the truth, you know, he was also converted. Hallelujah. You know, he had requested for some of the power of the disciples, but at the end of the day, when he interacted with the truth, he was converted. Hallelujah. Now, listen to this. The Samaritan woman at the well, my God, you remember that story. She lived as an adulterer. An adulterous woman. What do we see? Jesus is not taking her through deliverance class. By interacting with Jesus and Jesus telling her the truth and speaking truth into her life, she became the best evangelist of her days. Hallelujah. The entire nation, my God, almost everybody was converted to receive Jesus. Amen. The Samaritan woman, after knowing the truth, my Jehovah, she was delivered. She was not taken through any deliverance class. She never bought any oil, my God, with her handbag. She never carried any oil with her handbag. She never bought any sticker that Jesus would go watching over her. Hallelujah. In her house. She just interacted with the truth. And as she interacted with the truth, she was delivered. Simple. Church, it is that simple. Can we stop complicating the gospel? Hallelujah. My God, the woman caught in adultery. The Bible says she was caught in the very act. And when she was brought before Jesus, Jesus did not condemn her. Hallelujah. Interacting with the truth, Jesus is telling her, go and see no more. Hallelujah. That is it. She's delivered. You're interacting with the truth, you are delivered. Hallelujah. And simple as that. Is as simple as that. Church, are you hearing me? Is as simple as that. My interaction with the truth. As long as I have interacted with the word of God, the word of God will purify me. It is water that is able to cleanse me from any form of filthiness. Hallelujah. Because in what? In the Bible says the Spirit of God will teach us all things. You know, the Spirit of God will begin when I interact with the word of God, when I sit and hear the word of God, when I study the word of God for myself. The Spirit of God that is a deposit within me is able now to duplicate me, to purify me, to cleanse me, and to give me, my Jehovah, the stature, the full stature of the Son of God. And this calls for maturity. Hallelujah. Mary Magdalene, you know, after 7 demons were delivered from her life, you know, after 7 demons were delivered from her life, what do we see? She's from that time, she's not turning back. She's following Jesus. She's following Jesus. So that means, my God, I want to read for you this Matthew 12 and verse 43. The Bible says, Matthew 12 and verse 43, the Bible says, when an unclean spirit goes out of a man, he goes through dry places, seeking rest, and finds none. The Bible says in verse 44, then he says, I will return to my house from which I came. And when he comes and he finds an empty, you know, when he finds that space, There is a vacuum. Somebody has not received the Mary Magdalene. The demons were cast out of your life, but then you have not received Jesus as your personal savior. You are not interacting with the truth. What do we see? That spirit will come back and will come back in force. My Jehovah, in a greater way, the Bible says, then he goes out and takes with him seven others, spirits, demonic spirits, and they come back. My God, they come back to you. Hallelujah. That's why you see people are going for deliverance one after the other. One day, 2 days, every time you are delivered, you are falling down, you are rising up, and nothing is happening in your life. There is no transformation. Why? Because when an evil spirit is cast out of your life, then what happens? Again, you are not allowing the Spirit of God to lead you, to counsel you, to teach you. You are not allowing the Spirit of God to dwell in you. You are not interacting with the truth, which is the Word of God. So what do you see? The evil spirits come into your life back in greater heights, and they are able to mess up with your destiny. Hallelujah. But this cannot happen to somebody who is in the Word, who is in truth. Hallelujah. Who is led by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. There is no such a space for demons to come back. Mary Magdalene, when she received her deliverance, she's following Jesus. My God, even to resurrection, Mary Magdalene is there. Hallelujah. She's serving Jesus. So there is no vacuum, my God, of an evil spirit getting back to her life, because there is no vacuum left after her deliverance. Hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. Church, I want to finish. Jesus is the Word. The Spirit of God is all over me here. Jesus is the Word, and he transforms. And when you encounter him, ask Saul, as he was going to Damascus, you receive transformation there and there. Saul received transformation there and there. He did not even need to, you know, a deliverance class because of what he had done before. Hallelujah. He encountered Jesus on his way to Damascus. And he knew him. My Lord, he knew Jesus Christ. He knew. When he encountered Jesus, he knew. And what do we see? An immediate inner transformation that changed the way of life in the life of Saul. Hallelujah. And that was that. He became, my Jehovah, immediately. He was transformed. And what do we see after that? Actually, the disciples who had walked and lived with Jesus many years, nobody has written much in the Bible than Paul. Hallelujah. The first will become last, and the last will become first. Hallelujah. And there was no vacuum of getting back to who he was before his encounter with the truth. That is it, my brethren. Hallelujah. So the demons, whatever oppression and whatever kind of a business and whatever Saul was doing before his conversion, those things could not come back to him. So don't tell me that an evil spirit can come back to me when I'm fully sold out to God. When kenosis, when I'm fully sold out, when I have died to self, when I've given myself fully to God, demonic spirits cannot come into my life. There's no access. I'm a son of God. There's no access. So I'm requesting the servants of God in the world, when you interact with the people, teach them the Word of God. Stop selling to them your oil. Stop taking them loud circles of deliverance, and they bring money to you, and they bring their things to you. Unless you are the one drawing to them those demonic spirits. I wrote a book some years back of what God revealed to me. How some of these diviners, they manipulate the atmosphere through demonic spirits, and they are able to draw in the air those demonic spirits. And my God, the people who are not set and ready, you know, in the Word of God and sold out to God, these demonic spirits, they are able to torment them. And so what do they look for? You know, they bring to you evil dreams. They bring to your life whatever. When a diviner is given a territory by the devil, so they are able to manipulate that atmosphere, and they are able to throw demonic spirit in the atmosphere, and they are able now to capture your spirit if you are not right with God. And so what do you look for? You go to them, and they'll begin telling you, I see, I hear. Somebody has planted this in your house, my Jehovah God. Hallelujah. And you know, these gimmicks have been on and off, you know, every day. It is a daily thing. And your life is not growing. You know, you don't have a stamina as a son of God. You cannot start on your own. Hallelujah. So what you need is the interaction with the truth. What you need is the interaction with the truth. I call that gimmicks because the Spirit of God said it, that is gimmicks. You know what is happening in some of these places that are covered up in the church? Selling of stuff. You know, the house of God is a house of prayer for all nations. It's not a place for selling things. Hallelujah. And I pray that everybody who is going to watch this video, God is going to deliver them by his grace. So what do we see? When you interact with the truth, people like the three Hebrew boys, Daniel, my Jehovah, somebody like Joseph, they have purpose to live a life that is godly. They are able to discern and to perceive that which is godly and that which is not, without nobody telling them. They are able. Hallelujah. And that is maturity. And you are able to learn from any manner of evil and to say not to any manner of ungodliness. Hallelujah. So in conclusion, I want us to read the word of God in the book of Colossians. Let us read this word of God in conclusion. I feel in my spirit I have finished what the Lord wanted me to handle this morning. God has raised me for that. I'll keep on correcting the error by the grace of God, because God has raised me in this generation for that. I'll speak out by the grace of God and with much humility, because it is the Spirit of God that is giving me the utterance in the name of Jesus. Amen. The children of God must be delivered. May the Lord deliver you from the hands where somebody has been taking advantage of the children of God. May the Lord deliver you. My God, you don't need to drink oil. Anybody's oil. You don't need to buy anybody's oil. The grace of a man or a woman of God cannot be packed in any oil. It is not scriptural. Hallelujah. There's nothing like that. Amen. There's nothing like that. Amen. My Jehovah God, the man of God can lay hands on a handkerchief. The shadow of the apostle of Jesus Christ was healing. My Jehovah, and the hem of the garment of Jesus healed. Hallelujah. It's just, connecting yourself by faith. And a man of God can pray for a handkerchief. You go and take it to a sick person and they receive their healing. That's an act of faith. Amen. That does not mean that you have carried. my God. Let me not go that direction. It is so painful. Amen. First chapter of Colossians, verse 20 to 23, the Bible says, let me begin from verse 19. For it pleased the Father that in him all fullness should dwell. In him all the fullness should dwell. Verse 20. And by him to reconcile all things to himself. By him, whether things on earth or things in heaven, having made peace through the blood of his cross. Hallelujah. So you don't need all those gimmicks. You need to be reconciled. The ministry of reconciliation is already perfected by the death and the blood of Jesus. Amen. The cross. And you who once were alternated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled. Are you hearing this? Hallelujah. That means if I have fallen, what I need is not somebody smearing oil on me, is to go back to my Father, because the reconciliation is already perfected in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and blameless and above reproach in his sight. Amen. The Bible says in verse 23, if indeed you continue in the faith, grounded. Are you seeing this? So my brethren, we should continue in the faith, grounded and steadfast. You should have the stamina. You should have the roots in truth. Be grounded. Continue in faith. Hallelujah. Be grounded. Be steadfast. Hallelujah. And are not moved away from the hope of the gospel which you had, which was preached to every creature under the heaven, of which I, Paul, became a minister. Hallelujah. Be grounded. Be steadfast. Continue in faith. Are you hearing this? These are the three things that are going to cause you escape from any manner of ungodliness, from the gimmicks of men, from anything that is not the truth. You'll be able to perceive it. You'll be able to know it. Hallelujah. So continue in faith, Son of God. Continue in faith. Hallelujah. Be grounded in the truth. That is the word of God. So sit under the counsel of a man or woman of God who is full of the truth, the word of God. Be taught the truth. Hallelujah. And be steadfast. Don't be on and off. Don't be on and off. Hallelujah. Don't be on and off. When you are on and off, The evil spirit can locate you because the devil is rolling like a lion. So he can locate you. And when you get that kind of an interaction, what you need is not deliverance. You need to get back to your senses and go back to your father. You have squattered, you have had, you have messed up with the prostitute. You are suffering there, eating what you're not supposed to be eating, living the way you're not supposed to be living. You don't need anybody to deliver you. You just need to come back to your senses as a son of God and connect yourself back. And connect yourself back where you belong as a son of God. Hallelujah. And the father is willing. We see the prodigal son. The father was expecting him. The father was waiting all the days. The father was willing to receive him back. And what do we see? He's received back and he's restored back. Not as a servant, but as a son. Because the praise of a son is always intact. Hallelujah. So this particular morning, the question of the Lord was, does a fallen son, does a prodigal son need deliverance class, need deliverance process? No, he needs to get back to his senses and go back to his father. Hallelujah. And that is it. The father will receive him back because the forgiveness is there. Hallelujah. Everything that he needs, it's in the presence of the father. He does not need to be taken through the processes of men. Amen. Now, in our daily time, that's why God has raised the servants of God. Amen. They have the deposit of the counsel of God, the wisdom of God, and that is it. So somebody does not, when you come and you are fallen, they don't need to sell to you their oil of grace, oil of mercy, oil of deliverance, oil of joy. My Jehovah, there are seven types of oils that are being sold now. You don't need to buy all that nonsense. Hallelujah. The person just needs to tell you the truth. Interact with the woman at the well. Tell her the truth. The adulterous woman, I'm not condemning you. You are interacting with the truth that is already delivering you. Hallelujah. And that is it. Hallelujah. And that is it. And it is a done deal. But don't go falling again and rising up again. The Bible says we are not those who are called to turn back. Amen. We are called to focus and to move ahead. Mary Magdalene, the kind of Mary Magdalene. Hallelujah. We are called to move ahead and continue believing, continue living a holy life, continue loving God, and that is it. Hallelujah. And you're going to enjoy the faithfulness of God. Amen. So the prodigal son, if you have gone out of the presence of your father and you are living with the prostitute, you are eating with the pigs, you are living below the standard of the will of God in your life, you don't need any deliverance class. The Lord is beckoning us. Go back. The minister of reconciliation is there, and it's already a perfected deal by the cross of Jesus. So go back to the presence of your father, and you are going to enjoy the faithfulness of God in Jesus' name. So I finish by what I'm hearing in the spirit. Be reconciled back. Be reconciled back. Oil will not reconcile you back. Anybody's oil will not reconcile back. Anybody's sticker will not reconcile back. Anybody's salt will not reconcile back. The presence of God, the presence of your father. My God, that's what you need. The presence of your father. Amen. The presence of your father is where your security is hidden, in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. So go back. When the prodigal son went back, he never squandered again. He's not sleeping with the prostitutes again. He's not eating with the pigs again. My God, there was everything that he needed in the presence of the father. And we don't see him get out of the presence of the father. That was an enough lesson in his life, in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. So any foreign son, any prodigal son out there, kindly don't look for somebody, a diviner, to deliver you. Go back. Go back to your senses and locate your father. Hallelujah. And go back. And you're going to enjoy eternal peace by the grace of God, in Jesus' name. May God bless us.